And I'm so happy to see you, that you all came out tonight for our Sonoma Valley community meeting with our sheriff, Sonoma County Sheriff Steve Freitas. So, and I want to acknowledge the Grange. You're at the Sonoma Valley Grange Hall, and the host of the meeting this evening is the Sonoma Valley Grange, and which I'm a member of. I'm your moderator tonight, Gina Cuclis. And I'm curious, raise your hand. How many of you here are members of the Grange? Raise your hand. Excellent. And for those of you who aren't a member of the Grange, let me tell you why you should become a member. So the Sonoma Valley Grange has existed since about the 1930s. The Grange itself has been around since the late 1800s. And this Grange Hall is really emerged as the community center of the Springs. We're working to bring more forums like this to you. A lot of community groups meet here. And because the Grange really is about community. It's about sustainable agriculture, supporting the local food development, and supporting community. So that's a good reason to join, especially for anybody in the Valley that if you live in the Springs, because your dues help support this building. It's $30. We have membership forms sitting by each door, as well as those two gentlemen are holding them up, but sitting by the door that you can take one when you leave. I also want to point out, we're halfway through a $250,000 fundraising drive to do some remodeling work in this building, including ADA in the bathrooms, but the big, big thing we're doing is to build a commercial kitchen. And that commercial kitchen is going to help economic development in the Springs by serving as an incubator opportunity for those people wanting to be in food-related businesses and need a location to make their products to get started. So that's part of what the Grange is all about. So I wanted to point that out to you and encourage you tonight to please consider joining the Grange. Next tonight, I wanted to acknowledge that with us, besides the sheriff, who I'll introduce in a minute, but a face I know that's familiar to a number of you in the room, and that is Brett Sackett. And Brett is the chief of police of Sonoma and also the head lieutenant at the Sonoma Valley substation. Basically, you could say our top law enforcement official here in Sonoma Valley. And he's somebody that I really appreciate working with. Tonight to help add some local detail that you, for some of your questions, that he may help the sheriff answer some questions. So I do want to point out tonight's meeting, I'm glad to see it. Everybody here, most all of you are all Sonoma Valley residents, right? Mm-hmm. Excellent. I just want to get a sense, anybody here up from Glen Ellen? Glen Ellen. Anybody from the city of Sonoma? A few from the city, and how about El Verano and the Springs? Yeah, I thought that's where most of us would all come from. And of course, I've been a resident of the Springs I've been about 23 years now, where my husband Roy Tennant and I live and raise our children. So this is my home and a place that I love and care deeply about. And that's one reason why I asked Sheriff Steve Freitas to come out here tonight, so we can meet and see our sheriff and ask questions and share our concerns. Sheriff Steve Freitas became sheriff in January 2011. He's been with the Sonoma County Sheriff's Office for 26 years, including being the assistant sheriff. And prior to that, he served as the chief of police of Windsor. City of Windsor, like the city of Sonoma, contracts with the county sheriff's department for law enforcement. And with that, I'll take and let Sheriff Freitas start off.
Good evening. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Can you hear your audio? Okay. First, I want to thank you for taking the time to come out here. This is my job to be out here. You are taking the time to come out and be involved, and so I applaud you for doing that. People ask me a lot of times at these meetings, what can I do to either help the sheriff's office? I tell them being involved and coming to these things and either asking questions or just giving me your input is a fantastic way to be involved. So what I'd like to briefly do tonight is talk about the sheriff, the role of the sheriff. Then we'll talk a little bit about the sheriff's office, talk about some challenges we're facing. I got a couple of questions before I came out via email to talk about a couple of specific crime things for the Valley. We'll talk about that, and then I'll just go into questions. And my favorite part of these nights is the questions. So I just want to encourage you to ask questions. A lot of people say, well, they'll come up afterwards and say, well, I didn't want to ask you that question. I didn't want to, you know, seem adversarial or tough. One of the, sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not good about being a cop for going on 30 years now, is you get a little thick skin. So, although I do want to definitely keep it respectful, don't worry about the tough questions. If I don't know, I'll tell you I don't know. If I know but I can't tell you, I'll tell you I know but I can't tell you, right? I'm not going to BS you. And then the agreement is I'm going to tell you what I think, not what I think you want to hear. Okay? And if we disagree, we'll talk about it. We talk about what we can do. My goal is to always try and find some middle ground. The people that really know me, people on different political spectrums have supported me, because I think that cops need to be here for everybody. Whatever you think, we all are in this together for public safety. Additionally, we're here this year tonight, Sylvia. She's the community services officer for the Valley. If anybody needs translation, Sylvia is here to do that for us tonight. If not, then we'll just go forward. So the sheriff. The sheriff is a constitutional officer. Every county in California has to have an elected sheriff, and all citizens get to vote for sheriff, whether you live in the county or whether you live in the city limits. The reason for that, and one of the big differences between a sheriff and a chief of police, is the sheriff is independent from the board of supervisors and from city councils. The theory behind that is, a chief of police, while very similar in day-to-day jobs, works for a city manager, right? And then they work for the town council. So basically the chief of police is, mercy might be a strong word, but totally under the control of the city council. And so his or her livelihood is under the control of those elected officials. So the sheriff may be an independent, in theory, if there's law enforcement, public safety things that need to be done with those other elected officials. That's why you have an independently elected sheriff and a district attorney. So as Gina said, I became the sheriff in 2011. We have an unincorporated county, and then of course other things that the sheriff does, and that's a question that people ask me. If I live in the city limits, if it's not Winter and Sonoma, not one of the contract cities, if I live in Cotati or Cloverdale or Santa Rosa, what does the sheriff do for me? Why do I get to vote for this guy? I don't see any sheriff cars around here. The reason is that the sheriff provides a lot of services to the citizens of the county, not just the patrol cars and detectives and things that you see in the unincorporated area. And some of those are the jail. The law says the sheriff has sole and exclusive control over the jail and its inmates. The security at the courthouse, which all citizens may have need of the courthouse, is provided by the sheriff's office. The sheriff is also the county coroner in the vast majority of counties. It's about 50 of the 58 counties. The sheriff is also the coroner. I'm not a doctor. We have doctors that actually do that work, but I am responsible for that task. Additionally, the sheriff serves all civil process throughout the county, whether it's a TRO being served or an eviction. If you're in the city limits, that's still the sheriff that does that. So there's many of those functions that the sheriff does that benefits all the citizens of the county, whether you live in the city or not. Additionally, just because of the size of the sheriff's office, we're the largest agency between San Francisco and I think Portland, Oregon. Some of the smaller cities just don't have the resources to do some things. So all bomb calls in the county come through the county sheriff. Marine enforcement, the lakes, the rivers, the ocean, San Pablo Bay, that's the sheriff. The helicopter unit, the sheriff. So we provide a lot of resources to the smaller agencies because there's just some things they cannot do. Big investigations, things like that. So that's another benefit that the sheriff does. A couple of crime things I was asked to talk about. Gang crime. The gang crime in Sonoma Valley, so now I'm talking the Valley, not the city of Sonoma. 2013 compared to 12 was down slightly. There was 85 events in 2012, 81 in 2013. The city of Sonoma saw, I think, 4 more events last year than 2012. But either way, the percentages are very low. So in the Sonoma Valley, the percent of crime that is gang-related is just under 6%. So of any crime or the calls that we get, it's about 5.75% are gang-related. In the city of Sonoma, it's about 3%. The county average, if you go outside of the Sonoma Valley and look at the county as a whole, it's about 8.5%. So the Valley has less, percentage-wise, less gang crime than other areas of the county. The other question I got was DUIs. Are DUIs on the increase? And actually, DUIs throughout the Sonoma Valley decreased by 12 when compared to 2013 and 2012. The city of Sonoma had 2 more DUIs, went from 70 to 72, I think. So that, even with those 2 increase, the whole area saw a reduction in DUIs and gangs. What I'd like to do is also just talk briefly about, what people ask, what's the greatest challenge currently at the sheriff's office? Obviously, there's the controversial the event in Santa Rosa where that boy tragically lost his life. Totally get that. The district attorney is looking at that case. I don't have that case. I can't talk about the details of that case tonight, so if you have questions about that, I'm sorry. I can talk about what does the investigation look like, about globally, how do those things happen, but the specifics I can't address, and I trust that the district attorney is gonna do her job and come up with something, and my hope is that we'll learn something from that event that'll make it better for all of us, the community, and the sheriff's office. Our biggest day-to-day challenge is what's called realignment. So a few years ago, the state of California went broke, right? They're not like the federal government. When they go broke, they don't print more money, right? So they're the state government. They just went into debt. And so one way to get out of that debt was they realigned prisoners and inmates to the counties. It's a really big deal. I'm going on 30 years now, and it's the biggest change in public safety that I've seen in my 30 years. So what happened basically overnight is they changed the laws about who could be in county jail and then who would be out in the community supervising inmates or criminals out in the community. The biggest difference was the county jail was built for basically people to stay there for a year or less. Before realignment, people stayed in my jail for an average of 22 days. That's the average. We've recently got a 15-year sentence to county jail. My jail wasn't designed for people to be in it for 15 years. No way. The biggest changes that are happening as a result of that are the inmates don't get the services that they would get at state prison. They're kept in their cells, actually, inmates in my jail.
Amber alert, sorry.
Oh, okay. That, my phone's doing it too, yeah, okay. I thought it was me in the microphone. I'm glad to actually hear that. It's not just me. I'm glad you're getting Amber alerts on your phones. Good for you. If you don't know how to do it, hopefully some of the other tech people here can show you.
How to stop it?
What's that?
Drive down the room.
Well, I get to put your phone on silent, but to get the information, yeah, information's sometimes good. So back to realignment. So what happened is that the inmates that came to the jail, they're prison inmates. They're used to those type of things that the prison has available that the county jail doesn't. So what I'm saying is the inmates that stay at Pelican Bay State Prison, which is the maximum security for California, they actually get more time out of their cells than some of my inmates here in Santa Rosa because our jail just was not designed for those long-term inmates. The other thing is there's a thing called prison politics. The inmates who would come to county jail on their way to prison, they would kind of leave those prison politics and wait until they got to prison. The gang assaults and those type of things, they wouldn't do it in the county jail. It was kind of neutral territory. We could even put some of the gang members together and there wasn't a lot of problems. That would wait until they went to prison. Now that they're here for longer term sentences, that's what's happening in our jail. And it's changing the culture of our jail tremendously. The other thing, and the elephant in the room about realignment that I want to tell people, especially taxpayers, so you pay attention, is that there was no money for healthcare. The jail is, some of you I can tell like me, are old enough to remember the show MASH, right?
Yeah.
Patch them up, get them to state prison. We would do basic dental care. It was good medical care, it's really good medical care, but it's not, for example, geriatric medical care. It's not hip replacements, it's not things like that. Now we're having to plan geriatric medical care in our county jail, and there's no money for that. It's a pretty big deal. My fear with realignment is that the state of California has a history, and I'm a lifelong Californian, I love California, but they have a history of pushing programs down to local government, starting with mental health in the 70s and the 80s, right? Then a redevelopment came along. These great programs, because I truly believe that locals, we can do better for our people, whether it's mental health people, whether it's inmates, whatever it is, we can do better than Sacramento can. Nothing against Sacramento, but I tell them, what's good for Sacramento might not be good for Sonoma Valley, right? So, but if they don't keep the money here, it could be a problem, as we've seen with some of the mental health service declines that we've seen over the past few years. And if that happens with realignment, that'll be a significant problem. So I've talked briefly about the crime things. My favorite part of these things is to get questions from you. I encourage you to ask questions. If you don't want to ask a question, if you don't, you know, you don't want to get up in front of a bunch of people and ask, and you don't want to fill out a card, what I'm going to do is I'm going to stay tonight for at least an hour and a half. I don't think I'm going to get that many questions. I will stay, I'll come out in the crowd. If you want to talk to me one-on-one, some people don't even want to ask a question, they just want to give me a comment. I'll stay around and we can do that. I'm here for you tonight. Again, this is my job to be here. I appreciate you taking the time to be out here.
Thank you. And speaking of questions, we're on the mics tonight, even though at the Grange Hall you could hear us without them, but because we're being video recorded by our local cable TV station, KSCY, and they need us to be on the mics in order to pick up the audio of that the recording. So we have two ways to answer questions tonight. we have coming to the mic that's over there. So stand up and go to the mic and keep it short and to the point. Please, no speeches, no stealing the mic opportunity to stand up and give your own speech. It's to ask questions and maybe share some information with Steve Freitas that you would like him to know about your neighborhood and the issue in your neighborhood. But for those of you who are a little bit bashful or don't like standing up to ask a question, we also have these two gentlemen passing out cards. And you can write the question down and bring it forward, and I'll read the question for you. So to get started tonight, I'm going to ask one follow-up to the question I gave. So I did have three individuals who emailed me and asked if I would ask a question for them because they could not come tonight. And one of the questions was about gangs, which you mentioned. This individual, by the way, is a member of our school board. Unfortunately, the school board also meets tonight. So our school board members weren't able to come. But he also asked about trends. Besides, what trends have you noticed in Sonoma Valley that we should maybe be aware of? Positive or negative?
Okay, well, I think the fact that at least in the Valley that gang events, any reduction is good. So 85 to 81, that's a positive trend, I would say. The other positive trend is, while I know that there's been some significant events, the majority of the 2013 gang events were drug-related was the highest. Parole, probation violations were next. Then after that, it was assaults and then vandalism. So I would say that a lot of the crime, I know we've had some violent crime, but the overall crime is not directed violent at citizens. And a lot of the gang crime, while still unfortunate, gang members have, you know, families and loved ones also, of course, is that much of the crime is gang-on-gang crime. We haven't seen, I don't think, correct me if I'm wrong, some of the bigger city stuff where there's truly random gang crime, such as businesses being embezzled and money taken and things like that.
You're correct. So when it comes to the gang crime, but most of it is crimes of opportunity. You know, gangs operate on fear, intimidation, and they make the money through theft and drug sales. So that's why the drug crime aspect of it is so high. There has been a couple random acts, but we believe most of them were misidentification. Poor citizens just in the wrong place at the wrong time have been identified as a potential rival gang member or threat. So luckily for us out here, we haven't seen the true random type of gang crimes that you see in other cities.
And the other trend I would point out again is that I think it's a very positive trend that DUIs are down, even that's I think it was down 10 or 12 over 1 year to the next. I think that's a very positive trend because drunk driving and the tragedy that causes is a terrible thing, so I'm glad to see that that's down.
So let me ask a follow-up to that, because I think one of the reasons why you were suggested to be prepared for that question is it has come up the issue with the growth of wine tasting rooms in the city of Sonoma around the plaza. Is there any kind of correlation between that and DUI? And some people I know in Sonoma have raised that issue.
Okay, so I don't know specifically. If Brett doesn't know, we could find out and get back to you. So I would say if you've seen an increase in wine tasting rooms last year, there was less DUIs last year than the year before, so that's how we would have to figure that out. But again, DUIs are down, not up.
That's correct again. And to maybe add some context to Gina's question, in the city of Sonoma, they're obviously discussing at the planning commission level, and then now at the city council and planning commission will have themselves a joint meeting to discuss wine tasting. And it's important to realize that it isn't necessarily just about wine tasting. It's a little more complex than that. It's really about wine bars and tap rooms is what we're really trying to focus on. Nowhere in the staff report recommended by the planning department and obviously approved by the planning commission was a cap on tasting rooms. Something the council can certainly consider and will probably be vetted out quite a bit during that study session. But it really is talking about, is there appropriate regulation for a very narrow scope of wine tasting facilities that are actually under a license for tap rooms and kind of generic wine tasting facilities.
What do you mean when you say tap room, in case people?
So a tap room, like for instance, one of the questions that comes up is, if you are a legitimate winery, and I'll just use the name Cundy, it could be anyone, but if you're a legitimate winery and you make wine, statutorily you're allowed to have an off-site tasting room where you can provide your wares to people who want to come taste it. So they're statutorily allowed to have by the code. There's a new industry for people who come in and they want to open up wine tasting rooms where they broker 10, 12, maybe 14 different wineries. And the rules for them are substantially different. And there isn't necessarily an ABC license that is applicable just to what they want to do. It really is an on or off sale beer or wine license. And so if they get this Type 42 wine tasting facility in the city of Sonoma, they can literally open up a beer bar. They can have beer taps. As a matter of fact, we experienced that in the city of Sonoma where somebody came to me and they said, we want to open a wine tasting facility. We approved it. There's no conditions placed on it. There's no requirements, no oversight by the city whatsoever. So retail use, it's deemed approved. And then they put up the curtains and they did the remodel. They opened up and they had 6 beer taps in there. And I said, whoa, I threw the flag and said, that's not what we talked about. And went to ABC, and ABC said, unfortunately, absent local regulation, there's nothing that ABC can do about that. They have a right to sell beer, they have a right to sell wine by the glass, and they can stay open until 2 o'clock in the morning. So that is what kind of started this discussion, I think, at the Planning Commission.
Thank you for that history, and that probably is what the question is related to. But again, the good news is DUIs are down, so
yeah.
let's keep doing whatever it takes to keep the DUIs down.
Good news. Well, I do have some questions here and from the audience. So first one, could you speak about medical marijuana growing issues in the Springs? What are plant limits, and when does the Sheriff's Department get involved?
Okay, good question. This is a common question. And it's not just for the Springs or the Valley, but for the county as an entire issue. This is an issue. So first let me say, I have no issue with medical marijuana. State of California legalized medical marijuana. My job is to follow state law. It really, quite frankly, doesn't matter what I think or what my personal opinion is. My job is to follow the law. So we are honoring medical marijuana laws. My issue with medical marijuana or marijuana in general is the violent crime associated with it. So last year, I think, although we don't have a lot of homicides in Sonoma County, 75% of them were related to marijuana. The triple murder in Forestville, directly related to, that was marijuana. People from out of state, what's happening is, and I'll get to the Springs, but just the global issue, as Sonoma County and California has become more permissive on marijuana, whether you agree or not, other states still say it's illegal, right? So those people are coming to buy marijuana relatively inexpensively in California, and then going back to those other states where it's illegal, and some of that violence is coming here to California. Again, last year, 75% of the murders were marijuana related, and 100% of the home invasion robberies were marijuana related. So that's my main issue with it, is the violence associated with it. A common question I will get, and I'll answer it now in case I was gonna get it, is if we legalized it, wouldn't that solve that problem? Possibly, but just remember, we would need to legalize it everywhere. It would need to be legalized in other states, because if it's just legal in California, but it's not illegal in Texas or Alabama or wherever, the people that got killed, I think, were from New York and New Mexico. So if it's not legalized everywhere, it's going to have to be legalized and treated like alcohol, tobacco, something else, and regulated for it truly, I think, to reduce that crime. Here specifically, there isn't a specific limit on plants. The county ordinance actually says 99 plants. They talk about changing that to 30, but what's happened is a court case has come out. It's called the Kelly decision. And what that case says is, it's whatever your doctor says you need. If your doctor says you need 1,000 plants, that's your limit. If your doctor says you need 2 plants, that's your limit. And that's the law that we have to follow, regardless of what the county ordinance says. We have to follow state law. Federal law doesn't apply in the marijuana area to me at all. I'm not a federal officer. I can't enforce federal law, even if I don't want to. I'm here to enforce your laws, right? Not federal laws. And so they have people that do that. And the federal government is still doing a lot of marijuana enforcement on the North Coast. They don't even, a lot of times we don't even know about it, they just do it. But as far as state law goes, there is no specific limit. It's whatever your doctor says you need for your medical condition. And then the way that we determine that, the way that we get involved, is say that somebody calls and says, my neighbor's growing marijuana. I don't know if they have a medical license or not to have, or medical card to have marijuana. We'll go check those out to see if they're medical ones. And then we try it, if they're truly legitimate medical grows where they're within all the guidelines, we leave everything, we try and educate them to try and be conscious of their neighbors, because Brett mentioned a couple of just misidentifications. We've had several home invasion robberies where they're coming to take this person's marijuana, they get the wrong house. They go next door, and if you're the people in that house, that's not a pleasant experience. They usually come in, they're armed, scary. It's a terrifying event. People have been tied up, pistol whipped. It's the wrong house. So we really try and work with those people to keep their marijuana under wraps. They, you know, we don't want the whole neighborhood to know type thing. So if people call, I will say, last year I think we got over 300 complaints of marijuana. With the budget cuts, we have far less people to do that. So we only got to the top 160 biggest ones. Some of them just went. Patrol people tried to deal with it, but our narcotics unit cannot get to all of them.
I'm going to ask a follow-up to that. The one is, for those of us who've raised children, anybody at 18 can get a medical marijuana card. There are unscrupulous so-called doctors. As my daughters used to say to me all the time, all you got to do is go in and tell them you got a backache or you got a headache. What do we do about that issue?
Okay, that's a good question, and I've been asked that question before. The latest I heard is that doctors, of course, they're regulated not by laws that I necessarily enforce, their business and their profession codes, a lot of federal stuff about doctors' licenses. So the latest I've heard is you don't even need to go in anymore. You can just get it over the phone. They're running about 50, 80 to 100 bucks to get your medical marijuana. They don't call them a prescription because the doctors would get in trouble. They call them recommendations, right? We talked years ago about going after doctors who weren't even seeing patients, and we're just giving, basically they're making money by giving these away, and most doctors don't do it. Let me get one thing straight. Any profession, whether it's the cops, doctors, whatever you do, everyone makes mistakes, and the vast majority of people, or 90-whatever percent, are good people that are doing the right thing. It's only a few doctors that are doing this, right? Most doctors are good people and they're doing the right thing. But there is a cottage industry of doctors who do provide that service. We tried to work with the federal government to try and go do stings on those doctors, and the federal government was not interested in doing that. So the answer to your question is there's nothing we can do about that.
Follow up on that, are there marijuana growing taking place in a large scale in public lands and that kind of thing in the county?
Okay. So the question is, I'll repeat that because I know Gina wants to use the microphone. Is there large-scale public lands growing in Sonoma County? It depends on what your definition of large-scale is. Compared to some counties, no. But we do get grows of 1,000, 2,000 plants. Those are primarily in Sonoma County on private property. There's not a lot of public lands left in Sonoma County compared to places like Mendocino County, Humboldt, Siskiyou County. We do have that, and we always advise people to be cautious when you're out of public lands if you see marijuana. But mostly it's on private property. And a percentage of those, I don't know what it is this year, let's say about a third, it's on people's property. They don't even know it's there. The criminals and the growers go in on private property, on big parcels of private property, or maybe where people don't travel a lot, and they grow their marijuana there. Because if you're the marijuana grower, you don't want to grow it on your property, because if you're growing it illegally, we're going to take your property and sell it, and asset seizure your stuff. So they grow it on other people's property.
And I see that's people lining up over there.
Okay, great.
Hello.
Question?
Yes, you've actually sort of raised this topic and then moved on over the killing of Andy Lopez. And what's been really troubling me, I come from a time when it was not procedure to shoot to kill, and you didn't expect that any police officer, sheriff, would shoot before being shot at. And I'm really upset by how we've come to a place where it could possibly be within correct procedure for someone their official duty as sheriff to shoot a 13-year-old boy. What can be done to change the policy of the police and, the sheriff in this case? And I'm assuming that it's possible to change it because it's different from what it used to be.
Yeah, it hasn't, I don't know, different from what it used to be. I don't know what time frame you're talking about. It's been the same for quite some time since I've been in law enforcement. What it takes to change the policies get changed continuously through either new laws that are passed or court decisions that come out, and that's one of the ones that has changed frequently in that area. The sheriff's office and most agencies throughout California, over 90% have the same policy. I'm not commenting on it. I hear your concern that you don't think it's right, but that is the state of affairs. Hopefully through things like this, like I said, maybe we can learn some way to do something different, what can be done. I'll be curious to see when the investigation's done, I'm gonna be just as curious to see it as you are, and we'll see if there's things that we can do differently. Obviously no one, and I said right away, I have kids about that age. The fact that it was a 13-year-old boy just adds to the tragedy, but any loss of life is tragic. We had another shooting in Guerneville a few weeks after that one, where a person was shooting a rifle downtown Guerneville at people. That's tragic too. The fact that it's a 13-year-old, of course, adds to that. I absolutely agree with you, and I hear your anguish over it, and I respect that.
And is it up to the sheriff's department to set the procedures for their officers?
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
So it absolutely could change from there.
It absolutely could, and that's one of the things with the Board of Supervisors community task force that they're doing, and I am participating in that also. One of the things that we're going to look at is our policies. Someone mentioned at one of the meetings, well, New York has a different policy. We'll look at that and we'll see. Ironically, one of the documents that was provided, I believe it was by the ACLU, saying that the model policy out there is Dallas, Texas. And I haven't read it yet. I'm just saying, right? From what I understand, our policy is very close to that. But either way, I'm open to the conversation. If we can find a way to do things better, I'm always open to that conversation. And I absolutely appreciate you standing up and saying what you said.
I'm going to ask one of the other questions that was emailed to me in advance, because it relates to what this neighbor was just asking about. And this individual wants to know now, are you now in favor, I know the Board of Supervisors is the panel that was appointed, is looking at the issue of Citizens Review Board to investigate and review all officer-involved shootings and make the results public. How do you feel? Do you agree? What do you think about Citizens Review Board? Yes or no?
Well, it would depend on the model. There's a lot of different models. So I want to see, this task force right now is going to be looking at different models of citizen review. From what I've heard, many of them, for example, I think San Diego's, I heard, their model, the citizen review panel is actually sustaining allegations less than the sheriff's office was before that. So that's kind of interesting to me. So I would want to see what the model is. I'm open to the idea of citizen review. I think we have a lot of citizen review already between the media, the grand jury. I think there's a lot of forums for that to create another one. As long as we have the money to do that, I'm open to the discussion. I would just want to see what the model is. I don't think I should be the one, because of some of the concerns that people have why we need citizen review, I'm assuming you don't want me to create it. So I would want to see what the model that comes out of the task force working group is before I can really say if I support it or not. But the concept, yes, I support that.
Moving on to a different topic of a question here on a card. This is about domestic violence. And somebody said they read in the newspaper reports that a person who makes a threat against their spouse is charged with terrorism. How did this begin? Is it funding related?
No, and that is a disclaimer. I don't make the laws or write them. I just enforce them. the title for that crime is terrorist threats. And that is, it's not just domestic violence related. If you threaten someone else with great bodily injury, and that person believes that that threat could be carried out, they're legitimately in fear of that threat. It's section 422 of the Penal Code, and the title is terrorist threats. And why they called it that, I don't know, but it has nothing to do with terrorism that we would commonly equate with terrorism.
Next question from the audience here. Can you please explain the Trust Act and how it affects detainees for ICE in Sonoma Valley?
Yeah, good question. I just had a public meeting about this in Santa Rosa, I think 2 weeks ago. So historically and currently, the state of the federal government is, if the federal government, there's a program called Secure Communities. Every person that goes into my jail and every other jail gets fingerprinted. Whether it's me, you, anybody. Those fingerprints go to Sacramento, then they go probably to Washington, D.C. or somewhere to the federal government. Those are eventually shared with ICE, part of Homeland Security, and they issue a detainer if they think the person is in the country illegally, or if they don't know, and then they want to come talk to that person to see if they're here illegally. California has long believed the federal government was putting detainers on people who shouldn't have detainers put on them, for whatever reason. California, my county jail, other county jails, jail beds were being taken up to the percent of about maybe 15 or 20%. That people were being held on ICE detainers from the federal government. The concern was, are there these truly violent people who need to be in jail? Or are they basically minor offenders who, if it was anyone else, you would get out with a citation or some other means of getting out of jail until your court case was heard? So California passed what's called the Trust Act. And what the Trust Act says is that sheriffs have discretion, because the previously federal law, what the actual section says from federal law, it says it right on the detainer, is you, local law enforcement, me, you shall maintain custody for at least 48 hours or until we figure this out. So when the federal government tells me shall is a big word in my business. It doesn't say you may or would you pretty please. It said you shall maintain custody. California has now said you don't have to. And so as an elected and as a public official, I'm a little bit of a quandary. I got federal law saying this, state law saying this. The decision I made was I'm a state constitutional officer for California, so I'm going to follow California law until the federal government tells me to do something else. And quite frankly, I like the California law better because it gives me discretion, and we can talk. That's why I had a public meeting a couple of weeks ago about who we think should stay in our local jail. Should the beds be tied up by someone who maybe was just driving without a license or maybe stole something? Should they be taking up a bed in my jail, which is very expensive? So what we've done here, now that we have discretion, we're developing a policy regarding the Trust Act, and our plan is to hold only felons, no misdemeanors, and so far what that's resulted in is the ICE detainers that I got in January, we rejected 75% of them. And so,
So this next question relates to what you were saying earlier about realignment. And this individual wants to know what taxpayers can do, what we can do to assist with the prison overcrowding and the services being transferred and the funding issue, and what's your advice on how we can help?
Pay attention. You don't see a lot of articles in the paper about realignment, do you? How many of you even heard the term realignment before I showed up here tonight? That's pretty good. You're an educated group, right? Realignment is not a hot topic in the news. They call it some different names in the media. Absolutely pay attention. Your people in Sacramento, you know, our elected officials in Sacramento, this is not a federal thing, it's a state thing. Make sure that they keep the money coming. There's about 450 offenders that previously would have been in state prison that are here now. About half of them are in my jail, the other half are out in the community, and they're now monitored by county probation and the sheriff's office with some help from our friends at the Higher Patrol. And we're monitoring these people. The state used to do it, but they don't do it anymore. So we're doing it. The other kind of quirk, I would say, with a polite way, hopefully, to say it, was that realignment was billed as they're just low-level offenders. They're called they call them non-non-nons, non-serious, non-sexual, non-violent. But that's only the kind of the trick, the rub of that is, that's only for their current event. They may have a criminal history that shows they're extremely violent. And what we found in Sonoma County is about 75% of the people we've gotten are actually high risk to reoffend. So it's very interesting.
Do we want to go back?
I just want, because a number of people came in a little bit later. Tonight, we need to use the microphones because we are being recorded to broadcast this on KSBY TV. So we have two ways to ask questions. One is to come to the microphone over there and stand up and ask your question yourself. And for those of you who are more comfortable having me ask the question for them, we have two gentlemen passing around these orange cards, so you can write down your question and they'll bring it to me to ask for you. So next, how about over at the mic.
Hi. Yeah, I'm going to go back to the topic of vandalisms. It's been almost 4 months since your deputy shot the building. So I'm just wondering, you as the leader of that department, what changes have you made in those 4 months even to ensure that doesn't happen again to my son or to another child in the county?
Yeah, I get asked that, what are we going to do to make sure it never happens again? I think that's going to have to be several things. Some people are saying
I'm changing the protocols, right. And procedures. What are
so we're doing? Yeah. We're starting now that Santa Rosa has finished their actual investigation. And it's a big giant thing.
Yeah.
When they give it to the district attorney, she'll do that part. We're starting to do ours to get the details.
Right.
And any changes that come will come after we've reviewed that investigation.
Well, you did some review because you allowed him to come back to work. So you did do an initial review, which found that Eric Gelhaus hadn't broken any of your particular protocols or procedures, so he was welcomed back to work at one point.
Well, how about you doing right now?
Right.
Like now.
So we're doing our investigation.
Okay, so just investigating, you haven't made any changes yet.
No, and Eric was, the way that was We did not determine that no policies were violated at that time because we haven't done the investigation. No, it said it's based on what we knew right then, and he was medically cleared to come back. He's doing administrative office duties.
I knew that. The other thing is, I think the reason that New York was mentioned was that the average, let's say, I believe the average shooting rate, you know, police shootings to the citizen population is about 1 in 1,000,000. I know, you know, a couple years ago they killed officer involved shooting for killed eight people, and there's roughly 8 million people there. But here in Sonoma County, it's more like 1 in 100,000. You know, last year we had 4 people shot. And so I think that it's indicative and it's imperative that that the department look for changes and try to make real changes, because other departments have been doing it and can do it. And it starts with you. I mean, I feel like this is an opportunity for you to step forward and have real leadership in this and really make a difference.
My question
to you is also is that another piece of this puzzle is people, like you mentioned the shooting in Guerneville. And surely a man was having a mental breakdown and was shooting at people. But one of the officers involved in that shooting, I noticed, Henri Boussani, that was his third citizen that he had killed in this county. He had killed 2 people in 2004 and then that man there. And I'm just wondering, what is your policy for people coming back to work and being out on the streets if they've already had shown a record of being involved in officer shootings?
It depends on the shooting. They're each unique and case by case. I'm trying to answer that question. And I believe all of Henry Bassani's shootings were someone with a gun shooting back.
If I'm wrong, let me know.
I make mistakes every day.
He's also a great training officer.
Can you get us back on track? This is not negativity towards the sheriff. This is
Yes, please go to the mic and ask your question over there. Not shout up in the audience. Thank you.
I'll give my card to call.
Okay. So then you don't have necessarily a policy.
When they're medically cleared, and we're not allowed to know the details, there's a medical privacy law in California and throughout, when a psychiatrist says they're suitable to come back.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on to the next question and another topic. This person is asking about animal cruelty. It feels like animal control in Santa Rosa really hasn't been responsive and it's rather dismissive when being called about animal cruelty cases. And is there anything the sheriff's department can do?
I'm sorry, I don't do animal control. the one thing we do, if you're being attacked by animals, if there's vicious animals, we will do our best to come and try and help you. I know that if we're talking the valley, that is animal control. I'd be happy to pass on the concern, especially if you have a specific one and you want to give it to me. I'll be happy to be your conduit, so to speak, to the person who runs animal control. More specifics, the better. If you're talking about the city, I know that they do animal control, so I'm not sure what the direct problems.
So maybe the person whose question is at the end could come and give you some specifics. And again,
absolutely. I do need to go at 8:00.
Okay. So, what time is it? All right. Because this is another quick question here.
7:15.
And it's 7:15.
Yes.
Okay. We got time. This individual lives on a block with a suspected drug house with heavy daily traffic, and she wants to know how she and her neighbors can remain safe, and how do they cooperate correctly in removing the situation? What should they do or not do?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm not sure if that, one thing that you can do is, the vast majority of criminals, including drug people, they don't want to be noticed. So if you're pretty convinced that they're that outward, I would encourage you to call the sheriff's office. Sometimes it may be difficult for us when they see a patrol car come, right? That's not when they're going to do their stuff. So the first thing to do is to report it. And sometimes it takes several reports until we can catch them actually doing something wrong. Depending on how many people own their property, if the sheriff's office gets called enough, there's enough problems there. There's nuisance lawsuits that people can file, and that's happened in several areas of the county where you get a small claims judgment against somebody for being a neighborhood nuisance. It works effectively well if people are renting their property and you go after the landlord. And if there's more specifics, and whoever asked that question, again, as long as I need to go about 8:00, if you want to come up and tell me specifically, and I did get the email I mentioned about some of that stuff, and I'm more than happy to put you in touch with Brett, and we'll do our absolute best. The one positive that you have here in the Valley is that with the Valley Substation and the Police Department both being the Sheriff's Office, and compared to other areas of the county, there's probably more deputies here than, say, for example, West County or other areas. So there is, for example, the response time in the Sonoma Valley for an emergency call is 7 minutes. It's like 18 minutes in the West County. So that is a fortunate thing. So we do have more opportunities to do neighborhood enforcement like that. The other thing is our neighborhood enforcement team, which we call the COPS unit, was cut in the budget. So we are limited in that area these days.
Because I have a question here, speaking of that. So I do have a question when this individual wants to know, what is your office doing to supplement the lack of resources and manpower that the deputies in this area face?
Yeah, so the one I mentioned before that I'm independent, so the Board of Supervisors, the one that he was talking about policy, I can change my policies unilaterally, the board can't do that, but they do control my budget. They absolutely control the purse strings. They give me X amount of money, and then I decide how to spend it. So I can't supplement my own budget. I'm happy to have you try and help me with the board to get more budget. I will absolutely say that. But I don't like to come to things and criticize the board for the budget. I actually admire the fiscal responsibility of the board. We balance our budget every year. Some of that pain is borne by public safety and other county entities. But I am proud of Sonoma County for balancing their budget every year. So I think that's good. As things get better, I would like to see some of those programs come back, like the COTS unit. What we have done to try and supplement it is be creative with our money. So I mentioned to somebody, we talked about asset seizure money. One of the things when I became sheriff is when I came from Windsor, we had a youth diversion program, an intervention and diversion program that provided counseling and not only drug counseling, but alcohol counseling, family therapy, anger management counseling. And I said I wanted to bring that to the county. Similar, Brett, as we have a diversion program in the city of Sonoma. So one thing that I'm very proud of is that now we have, through the use of asset seizure money, we've spent, since I've been sheriff, $360,000, and we have youth, specifically for youth, around drugs and gangs for intervention and prevention programs in the Sonoma Valley through a group called CYO in northern Sonoma County, western Sonoma County, and now in Petaluma through the southern Sonoma County Boys and Girls Club. So what I'm trying to do is use that money, and then we partner with nonprofit groups to provide intervention and counseling services, so hopefully we can get to people before they ever need the cops.
A couple people here have asked the same type of question, and that has to do with noise and cars, skidding, speeding, noisy neighborhoods because of a lot of speeders, and what can be done about that? Particularly, one concern is particularly it happens a lot around El Dorado School.
Okay, I'm probably going to punt this one to Brett. Except for to say, we know that in the unincorporated county, the sheriff's office doesn't have a traffic division or unit. That traffic enforcement is provided by the California Highway Patrol. Again, I'm happy to pass on concerns, but deputies, their main job is not traffic enforcement. If they see a violation, they of course are free to take action, but deputies don't sit and work radar. That's, and things like that, like school violations, that's what the Highway Patrol is. In the city of Sonoma, of course, Brett is a full service agency just like Windsor is and does traffic. But for specific traffic complaints, again, I'm happy to take them, but the actual enforcement in the unincorporated county, you mentioned that El Verano is the Highway Patrol. But Brett, maybe you can help me out with that.
Yeah, the sheriff kind of answered everything that needs to be said about that. In the unincorporated areas, the Highway Patrol is the traffic division. So I am actually meeting with the commander of the Napa office, which is the one who actually controls the Sonoma Valley. I'm meeting with him next week fortuitously, so I will pass on your concerns to him. And we are reaching out to him and his agency to assist us with kind of some intensified kind of assistance in the kind of area right around El Verano, ironically. We went to a Safe Routes to School meeting where they attended it, and we heard a lot of these same complaints, and so we're developing kind of a plan to get them out more frequently to do some traffic enforcement over there to see if we can reduce those complaints.
So why don't we go over there? I think there's some people standing in line wanting to use the mic and ask a question over there.
Go for it.
Every so often I take the 30, the bus, and I've noticed that there's some very strange people that get off. I live in Kenwood. And it's to my attention that I don't know if I should call the police or the county, which I've complained to the county before, that they live in the creeks. And deep behind needles, razors, and a lot of people don't want to speak up because I know they're homeless, but I don't know if they're crazy. And the 30s kind of difficult. But I don't know if it's a situation that you call the sheriff and say, hey, there's some strange people in my backyard that are coming up from the creek and want streets. They get off the bus and they're there. I'm not sure if it's a problem with permits and resources for having some of the houses that are vacated where these people may be living. So I've noticed a comment that in some suburbs of Santa Rosa, it's like a free-for-all, whereas in other places, restaurants have to play by the rules, pay for permits to have a clean restaurant, where then there's other areas of Santa Rosa where there's vendors on the streets, they're selling out of parking lots. It just seems to me that I don't know who to call. Who's in charge? Can the sheriffs get on this about having different homeless people living in the streets, or is it the county that has to shut down businesses, shutting down businesses that aren't legitimate? I mean, it's...
I'm going to try and encapsulate the questions there. So the one I heard was, who do you call if you see, especially if you see strange people walking through your yard? That's definitely you call the sheriff. Absolutely. Again,
we kind of know that there's a series of homeless.
Okay, so I'm going to go to that one next. But just so you're clear, you call the sheriff's office. The best number to call for that is 565-2121.
Not the 911.
Yeah, 911 is someone's getting hurt, right? Someone's on my property. I don't know who they are. That's 565-2121. As far as the homeless camp in the creek, that would be us also. One of the areas that, and I know people get frustrated with, is all calls that come in are prioritized. They're one, twos, or threes. And let's say there's maybe a homeless camp in the creek. Right? No one's being actually hurt right at that time. So if we're going to that, and then a two or a one comes up, someone's being hurt, right? And there's something else, we'll get bumped off of that. So we have trouble getting to those. I will openly admit that. The cops unit was who primarily did things like that, and Brent used to work for the cops unit. When we would get a homeless issue wherever in the county like this, the cops unit would go and take care of that for us. Now it's been pushed down to the patrol deputies who are handling the other calls for service that are in what we call the queue, the line of calls. So we will eventually get there and look at it and see if it's public property, depending on where it is. Needles, of course, are not okay to be left around.
Are they arrested for doing this, or are they just told to move along?
Depends on if they're committing a crime. If they're actually committing a crime, it depends on if the creature is private property. So I don't know the specifics of that. But if they're committing a crime, they can be arrested. But many times, it's a nonviolent crime, it's a misdemeanor. They'll be cited out and then appear in court at another day. As far as you mentioned the businesses, yeah, that's the permit resource division. I can't go shut down businesses. They do that.
So if like all the streets and they're selling on the street, that's legal in one part of town and not in another?
It depends. Well, the county, all the county ordinances would be the same. Santa Rosa would have their own rules. Sonoma would probably have different rules than the county, depending on what they're doing. If it's someone who's operating a business, like a vendor, let's say, who's operating a business that's not licensed and done, or whatever it would be, that would be permit resource management. We used to work together on those when we had the cops unit, but now that we don't have that anymore, that's totally on them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next person.
Mr. Freitas. Hello. Thank you.
Hello.
Thank you for coming out here. City Beach is a public forum, and thank you to Grange for putting us on. I've been in this valley, I came in 1969, and basically raised in Sonoma County. So I've seen a lot of changes. And there's no question, changes in history, changes in policy, nationally, we've all gone through that, but there's no question I've seen changes in the way the Sheriff's Department and police agencies operate. You're aware of that as well. And though even in the 70s we had more crime in many areas, including drunk driving, which is out of control, and elder abuse, as you know, we're actually a much safer society in so many ways. You put out some areas where we're not, of course, we're growing on invasion. My concern has been, I've had some wonderful interactions with some of the people who work for you, that you're in charge of. And I've had some individuals who, unfortunately, they're let's say, entirely wild. I've had friends who are in the department, sheriff and otherwise, and live in the Bay Area, so I know it's a really tough job. And my concern is whether or not these men and women are getting the kind of vacation time, the kind of counseling time, the kind of time to really decompress. It's a tough job. And I'm wondering, really, if you're looking into seeing a little bit more work being done in regards to sensitivity as well. They're peace officers. And so I want to tie that into one other thing, which is I have children. have a number of children, and I have a lot of friends with children, and I've noted that a lot of the young people are a little nervous around police officers. They've seen things. And local police departments have done a lot to hand out little badges and keep things. And I would like to know if in the future, your public relations would be doing more so that my teenagers and younger children, and children of my friends, can feel more comfortable about police officers in general.
Okay, thank you. I know, I would assume, Sylvia might be the best one to answer that question about handing out badges. I know we do a lot of school things. We go to schools, we do reading at schools. I'm sure Greg can talk about that too. We do a lot of that. Do we do as much as some police departments? Sheriff's offices are always challenged with that type of specific activity, purely by geography. So for example, Sonoma County. Sonoma County is the largest of all the Bay Area counties. I have individual beats in Sonoma County. When you see cop shows, it's the beat or the zone or whatever it is. We have beats bigger than Marin County. Right? Some of those beats have two deputies that are on duty. It is hard to get around and pass out the badges and do that. What I hope and what I encourage people, and I've heard, and Brett and you know other people that work at the sheriff's office can say, I am doing my best to implement a customer service type of attitude. What happens is that most times when people call the cops, what I tell people is, and I mentioned this before, cops get kind of thick-skinned, right? When most people call the cops, you don't call us because, hey, my kids graduated from the school, or we're having a birthday party, come on over. You call us because there's a problem. And even the people, I mentioned 95% of the people, or whatever the percent is, they're good people. They're really good people. But when they call us, they're experiencing a problem, right? And it's many times a difficult interaction. So as I mentioned, we have about 800 people that work at the sheriff's office, and the vast majority were fantastic people, right? Sometimes, like you mentioned, though, you have a bad experience. I get that. What I encourage people to do is call us and let us know that, because if we don't know, we can never fix it. Going back to your specific question of do they get enough vacation time? I think so. And I think compared to when I started 30 years ago, there was no programs like we have peer support. The sheriff's office, we have counseling and mental health programs. When I started 30 years ago, there was none of that. So is it as good as it should be? Probably not, but it's way better than it was. And I'll tell you, it's far more acceptable for people to avail themselves of those programs than it used to be. So when people do that, when we do debriefings about events, people come and they talk and they share their feelings. That is more common now than it used to be. Of course, we still have room to improve, and that is something, though, that yes, we are aware of. The idea of decompressing and sensitivity, that is something we talk about and we actually train for, and we have several programs, but again, we could improve more, but it is way better than it was.
Not to be too big of a thank you, but I'm aware of how much you have on your plate. But in studies that have been looking at our European counterparts in Germany and Switzerland, and I know that you probably have gone to review these things, there is per capita less, because they have actually more vacation time, more counseling, and more testing. And this has come up, I'm sure, you've heard it plenty. So
yeah.
Enough said on that. Just I would like to see more movement in that area, because I have come across some hardworking peace officers who, my experience was in a couple of cases, one involving a fiance not too long ago, of which a letter was written to your office and I never received anything back. And the woman who was my fiance at the time was actually related to the New Jersey police captors. So we were surprised not to get anything back. And I know you're busy, it's hard to get everything back. But two or three bad experiences and 90 good experiences, it'd be nice to see 99 good about that.
I'm always up for improvement, but if I can get to 95% good in my business, we'll start there and hopefully get better the way I do.
Thank you.
And I think Chief Zach has something to add.
Yeah, if I can just interject one thing real quick. So we do have a great program out here, and it's a wonderful partnership through the sheriff, the city police department, and the school district, which is our school resource officer. Your comments about getting into the schools and reaching the children when they're young and developing a rapport with them is super important to us. And it has been committed that way for the years and years and years since the sheriff has been out with the CDPE. So we do have a partnership. We have a school resource officer. Unfortunately, what we've seen in the last couple of years is he's so busy on the high school dealing with issues there that he isn't actually getting into the outlying schools as much as we'd like to. So recently, I met with the substation sergeants and talked about our desire just to see if we can get the patrol deputies to stop by the outlying elementary schools during the lunch hour and just stop and say hi, shoot some baskets with the kids, and you know, we'll do it as time allows, but you're right, it is highly important.
And that would be great. My older children got that, and it made a big difference. They're now 29, 30 doing their thing, and I had a friend who they expressed to me, they're not getting that attention in 2003, 2004.
Thank you. You made an excellent point. Why don't we move on? I'll just ask if we can keep the time at the mic a little shorter. What we're going to do tonight, I'm going to wrap up all the questioning by 7:45, so we have the last 15 minutes for people who want to come up and speak to the sheriff personally. So I should ask a question, and let's keep it to the point.
Sure. Okay, this involves an issue, a very serious issue, a big person. First of all, I am extremely upset about the Lopez incident. And I would like to see a richly unexplicated autopsy report on the Lopez shooting. But that's another issue. Right now, we have more laws in the United States than our people, as overpopulated as the United States is. We have half a county as many laws as there are people. I would be shocked if even 0.01% of all this legislation has any constitutionality, trace of constitutionality to it. You say that you uphold the law. You say you uphold the law. The law, unless I can get it so mistaken, is the Constitution. How can you uphold a law, which is the Constitution, and yet enforce unconstitutional laws, which abound in this country? There are more than 4,500 federal felonies. They don't even know how many federal felonies there are.
I'm just going to ask you, because you asked the question earlier, so let's...
If I understand the question is, how do I uphold the law? I do my best. There are a lot of laws. You're right. Again, I'll go back to I don't make the laws, and I'm not a legislature, so I don't create any of that. I do my absolute best to follow the Constitution. I'm a constitutional officer. Of course, the courts are who ultimately interprets that. I've had people say the Constitution says Second Amendment, everybody has the right to have a firearm, for example. But then the courts interpret that. So what we have to do in law enforcement is, I don't get the final say on what is and what is not constitutional. The courts get that. And that is where most of our policies on laws come from, is from court decisions, which of course in itself is constitutional. That's the system that we have. As far as the number of laws and the legislative laws, I don't know if I agree to the volume that you're talking about. I don't know, you may know more than me, but I know there's a lot of laws, and we do our absolute best to stay on top of them. And I've got lawyers at the county, we get updated all the time from the state, from the county about new laws, and we do our best to follow them based on court decisions and things that come out.
Thank you. I've got one other question here on an interesting topic. And this individual wants to know, how does a ex-gang member who's in Sonoma, who says trying to live a positive life, deal with if they've been stopped a lot because the sheriff knows that they were a gang member? Apparently somebody believes this has been happening.
Okay, maybe happening. Hopefully, if someone's really truly out of the gangs, a lot of times the deputies will know that, absolutely. One thing that I would encourage anybody to do who's now out of gangs, gang tattoos are very common, as many people know. The sheriff's office, through the money that I mentioned before, this $300,000 that we spent, we actually purchased for a group called SAY a tattoo removal machine directly for gang members to use to get rid of their gang tattoos. That would be one of the first things I would do. Don't dress like a gang member, right? So you're good. A person who is a gang member and now has come full circle and is out, we'll at least have enough rapport, I think, with the deputies to explain that, and we'll have should have evidence of being earnest in that. Many of the people that we use from, I mentioned, CYO California Youth Outreach to do our gang intervention and prevention are former gang members who we're now paying to do that. So we're totally open to the idea and encourage the idea of the term former gang members.
And next,
Mike.
I'm very concerned about the relationship to the Latino communities. stopped by deputies, forced to lie on the ground, handcuffed for 3 hours. When their parents approached to find out what was going on, one of the deputies turned to the parents, brandishing a weapon, and said they had to stand back or somebody's going to get shot. This scares me, because I don't want to see any more Andy Lopez's. And I want to hear your opinion about whether these officers, the youth, were armed with nothing more than poster materials for a yard sale they were going to hold the next day and a staple gun. Either your officers are repeating the error made by Deputy Gelthaus in not being able to discern a real weapon from a false weapon, or there's something terribly wrong in the relationship of your department to the Latino community. Do you respond to that?
I assume you weren't there, I wasn't there. One thing I found after 30 years is there's two sides to every story, and usually the actual story is somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
That's just life experience. So for that specific incident,
I mean, some of the individuals involved.
Okay.
And not
the government. I understand that. Okay. There's reasons at court, there's no hearsay. The people who actually see it are the ones. So what we hear and what we maybe read in the media, there's always a little difference here. I'm not saying this incident, I don't know this incident specifically.
There's two videos.
Okay. There's a lot of YouTube videos out there, I get that. So the call that came in, and actually came into the Santa Rosa Police Department, was from a citizen who didn't know any of this. It was just, some lady, who called and said, this person pointed a gun at me. That's the call. Describes the car, describes the person, and they found that person. Ultimately, you're right, it turned out to be a staple gun. But the call that came in was, they had a gun, and they threatened me with it. So the deputies made a car stop. Absolutely. I don't believe that anybody was out there for 3 hours, but I may be wrong. I'll look into that when I get back. I hadn't heard that before tonight.
Why did you put the kids on the street?
They put the kids on the street. I don't know this. I haven't looked at that specific event, but just to address that, the idea of the gun in the car, everyone is brought out of the car and usually laid down or sit on the curb or somewhere where we can check and see if there is in fact a gun. In this case, there turned out not to be a gun, but the citizen that called said there was a gun. To your question about the Latino community, when I first became sheriff, that was absolutely mentioned to me. So my earnest effort, and still to this day is, I created the Latino Advisory Committee. I think I'm still the only elected official in Sonoma County that has a sitting Latino Advisory Committee.
That's bias.
Pardon me?
That's not real.
Okay, so do I decide who, I think what you're going to say, I don't put words in your mouth, tell me if I'm wrong. I've heard people say, well, those aren't the real Latino community. Do I decide that? Do I know that? So what I did is I reached out to some people in the Latino community, and they picked the members on the Latino community. I didn't pick anybody.
You'd like to volunteer.
So, absolutely. We just added some members, and several people volunteered. And who decided to pick them was not me. The Latino Advisory Committee voted on who to pick. So what I would say was, it's not perfect, but at least I'm trying. And I meet with them, and I'll tell you what, I don't know everything about the Latino community, nor do I know what's best, but I'm absolutely open-minded to, they do, and they know better than me. That's why I'm at least trying to meet with them and get educated, and who they pick to be on their committee is up to them.
I would just like to add that the community is very anxious to see whatever future actions you take as a result of the Andy Lopez investigation to improve the quality of that relationship between your staff and the community.
As am I.
Going back to the Andy Lopez thing, and my wife couldn't be here, was really interested in this, was there were some reports in the Press Democrat that some of the witnesses have been harassed by sheriffs. So can you comment on that? Do you know anything about that?
I've seen the reports in the Press Democrat, I think. Some of that is what this lady was talking to. Some people said.
Oh, this would be earlier.
Yeah, I mean, mainly related, I believe, to the protests. I don't know if there are actually witnesses to the event. What I've heard is mainly related to the protests.
Well, I understand some people have been, you know, sort of routinely pulled over and...
Yeah, I don't know that anybody's come directly to the sheriff's office and said that. I've seen things in the media.
Yeah,
it turns people if you've got that. One of the things that, and we were doing this before the Andy Lopez thing, is that we're moving to personal, as many departments have done, law enforcement, is to personal video recorders.
Yeah.
So that when we get these things where it's, this person said this and we said this, you know, the lady mentioned YouTube, we're going to have our own YouTube. So hopefully, as much as we can share those to say, to show people, this is why this car was stopped.
Well, that would be fantastic.
I would agree with you. So that's why we're moving that way. And that was done well before this. I had already started instituting that and spending the money on that before this happened.
Actually.
Here? Okay.
Thanks again for being here tonight.
Thank you for being here. Very much. Quick question.
Our own chief here, cyclists going through red lights and stop signs. That's not my question.
That's not me.
And I'm a cyclist myself, right? We've not seen people do it.
Okay.
The average education of a deputy and the amount of training done and then continued training. In my own profession, it's continued 40 hours every 2 years. I'm curious about the continued education for a deputy and their average education.
That's a good question. I don't know the average education. I'd have to go back and find that out. I assume you mean, you know, average years of college, high school, whatever it is. I would have to go back and find that out. I have cards here. I'd be happy to give you one. I don't know if you either write down your name or information for me, I'll try and, I don't even know if we capture that, but if the county captures that on its application process, I'd be happy to share that. As far as ongoing education, the training, I think the police academy now, just to get started, is about 700 hours. Then you come into a training program that is about 4 months where you're with somebody. After that, the mandatory from the state is 24 hours every 2 years for things like, the state tells us, of that 24 hours, they tell us what we have to do is 16 of it. So for example, they'll tell us 8 hours on domestic violence and 8 hours on gangs, and then we get to pick 8 hours. Last year, we picked racial profiling, and everyone at the sheriff's office went through racial profiling, including me, went through racial profiling training. So in addition to that, in addition to those 24 hours, it's required every quarter for people to go to training, I think, is that 2 hours?
Well, yes,
2 hours every quarter that we do on our own. So the basic answer to your question.
Absolutely. So I'm going to, I made a promise, and I'm going to wrap up here.
Is it 7:45?
It's almost like 2 minutes away, and I promised somebody I'd ask you these questions. It's on a different topic. This is about enforcement of the smoking laws or the no smoking laws. The county, the unincorporated area, actually has more progressive laws than does the city of Sonoma. This individual has been concerned about enforcement. One, state law prohibits smoking in cars with children, yet sees this happening in the valley all the time and wants to know if there's any effort at all to protect the kids and enforce that law. And the other question relates to the counties now, you know, no smoking outdoors in public areas, and that apparently is not being enforced well in the valley either. What can be done to improve enforcement?
I'm gonna totally punt that one, but I think when the county adopted the ordinance, they did ask us about that, and we openly admitted that as far as enforcing smoking stuff, when we have people here talking about marijuana in their neighborhoods and drugs in their neighborhoods, I'm not sure what the city's doing, but I don't know that we even get calls for people smoking. If deputies see that, I don't know how they're prioritizing that. I would hope when it comes to kids and cars, I know that, again, we said deputies don't primarily do traffic. I tell people I'm kind of proud of that I have the same ticket book they gave me like 25 years ago. but one of my pet peeves, though, was kids out there, car seats, right? So everybody's got a thing that we want to take care of kids, right? So I could definitely ask Brett to pass that on to the deputies in the valley, that if they see that, that we can try and focus on that.
Yeah, and since, to follow up on that, you know, the smoking laws in the city and the county, a lot of times kind of patchwork of different things. There's prohibitions around playgrounds, there's prohibitions in multi-family dwelling units in the county. At the county level, the majority of that is the responsibility actually of the health department. And that's what's written in the municipal part of the county code. I met with them actually a couple weeks ago, so I'm part of a countywide partnership, and we went over some of the concerns that they had and really we need to get a better message out to the community that they need to really call the health department for follow-up and investigation and work with your landlord if you're in a multi-family dwelling unit. The city of Sonoma doesn't have that kind of ordinance. I think you may have read the paper. It just got recently out of death from, I think, the American Heart and Lung Association. So people have already contacted me and the planning department about looking at maybe tightening up some of the smoking regulations in the city. And it will come down, as the sheriff said, really about enforcement priorities. There's only so many people who are out wearing a badge to do law enforcement. And so we really have to be careful about where we focus our time. And not that smoking isn't one, but as we said, there's people talking about gang-related crime, we're talking about, you know, theft, we're talking about domestic violence. So there's only so much we can do. So it's really important to kind of educate and empower the community to kind of police themselves and kind of that.
Well, as I said, we wrap up the public question part at 7:45, because the sheriff has to leave the building by 8 o'clock. We wanted to have some time at the end with him for those of you who would like to come up and have your own conversation with him personally. And as I said, to watch tonight's video, go to sbtv.org, and it will be rebroadcasted on YouTube, correct?
KSBY.org.
Oh, KSBY. KSBY.org. We call it SBTV, KSBY.org. Thank you all for coming tonight.